Hello, my friends, and welcome back. I'm Rachel Archelais, founder of the Intuitive Art Academy. And today I want to talk about something that stops a lot of people from moving forward in expressing themselves or starting a business, and that is criticism. Especially being in the maybe alternative space, the more spiritual space, we can anticipate blowback. We can anticipate people not agreeing with us. And that can stop you from doing what you really want to do. And it can stop you from living the life that you came here to live. So we're going to talk about different ways to deal with criticism. And really the truth that criticism is going to be a very small part of what you are doing and what you are getting back from the world. So my experience with criticism in my business has been pretty minimal, thankfully. I've definitely, in my days as primarily a psychic, I had people, spouses and stuff, friends come with their friends to get a reading and, you know, sit in the corner and maybe be a little grumpy or tell me that they're a skeptic. It never bothered me. I just focused on who was there to interact with me. And usually the person who was waiting around being grumpy would come around and be like, oh wow, can you do me? Like this is amazing. So that never bothered me. But on YouTube, when I was first starting out, I would get some comments that were negative about being psychic. Like this is a scam, or, you know, just nasty things. And it does happen once in a great while now. I've had to block a few people, had to block somebody on Facebook, one on Instagram, a couple people on YouTube. But in the 10 years that I've been doing social media like this for my business, it's only come up a handful of times and it hasn't been that difficult to deal with. So luckily, because it's so far and few between and I get many, many, many more positive comments, it's easy to keep it in perspective. And it's easy to just kind of delete and block and go about my day. The thing that's harder for me still is when I get feedback, negative feedback from people that I know, students or friends. Now, this doesn't happen nearly as much as the negative comments happens, but when it does, it sticks a little bit harder because I know the person that it's coming from. I've realized that there are a few ways that I can interpret this. Now, I'll go back to the other versions of criticism too, but this one I think is what people are maybe most afraid of because they're afraid of the people they care about being disappointed or, you know, what they're creating, not living up to expectations. And I have to say that this is a good reason to create the business that you want to be in. And develop it to your standards, to your pleasing. And that way, when someone else is trying to suggest something else, you have the muscle of weighing it, of like, would that please me? Would I like to include that? Because sometimes you're going to get really great feedback. And it will sound like criticism, but it's constructive. And it's a helpful hint. Because we can only see things from our side of the table, it's often helpful to get another person's view, especially someone who's paid to be in your world. But you still want to weigh that in like, okay, well, maybe this is how they would do it, but is this how I want to do it? You get to make that decision. So luckily, I've got that. But when people are disappointed or insistent on something happening a certain way. Like, I've gotten comments over the last year that my program is boring, that people aren't motivated to go to it, and that they're not enjoying it. And it's only been a couple people, and I have lots of students. But let me tell you, the stacking effect of that took a real toll on me. And I was like, okay, first, I went through all the emotion. I was upset. I was mad, I was scared, I was insecure, I was like, finally, okay, let me look at this. How do I feel about it? What can I do that feels aligned to me to make this better? And does it need to be better? Does it need changing? Because the thing is, you're probably always going to get a small portion of your audience who's not jiving with it. And most of the time, it's not about you. I teach how I teach. I teach the same way that I teach in videos like this as I do in my courses. And so if you're doing your due diligence before you purchase something from me, there's nothing I can do to change that. I can't change my personality to suit one person, right? And I know I've bought courses that I didn't go to. I've purchased courses where I've gone to one or two classes and then not gone to anything else. And you know, sometimes I got what I needed and that was all I wanted. That one nugget that I got in the first class was enough for me and that was worth it. But we're not used to thinking about things like that. I know oftentimes when we join something, we think we complete it and that's it, or it's a waste of time and money. But I'm really a believer that you're gonna get what you need by following your intuition, and it might not be the completion of that thing. It might be the one thing you learn in the first 20 minutes. But that aside, when you get feedback or criticism, you really need to determine how you can take that. Is there anything constructive in there for you? And one of the things I'm asking myself about my course is, what is my best path forward? And I haven't done the drawing yet, but that is my prompt for here. Because I went through a lot of different feelings about it. Now, most people are extremely satisfied and they love it and it changes their life and they're like extremely happy with it. So that's a good thing to know. The second thing to know is I haven't redone it in a few years and it's probably time to do it again. You know, this is probably the fourth iteration that's up there. But I do like to redo the content every few years because my cameras get better and I look different and, you know, I know more. So I like to translate that into my classes. And so it makes sense that it's about time for that. But my first inclination when I thought that was like, okay, I got to do it all. I got to do it right now. And that is a really big undertaking. And so yesterday I realized, okay, I've done some of that. I've updated parts of it. I can upload that now. But I've got other things going on. I don't want to stop my whole life for a month and redo it all. And so I asked myself and my friend who I was talking with, like, what if I just do it bit by bit? What if I just update it like maybe one class a week or something like that? We both agreed that that felt really wonderful. So I know I'm sharing with you my whole big tumultuous story here, but I think it's a good thing to learn that you are in control. You are the one that needs to be pleased, not anyone else. Of course, you want to make sure that you have high quality stuff. Of course, you want to make sure that it's to the best of your ability, but your ability over time is going to change. And it's up to you to decide, how do I want to deal with that? Do I want to update things? Are they good enough as they are? And a lot of times, that is the message. It is good enough as it is. It is good enough the way that it is. It doesn't need changing or fixing, and you can't please everybody. So while you're doing a thing, do it to the best of your ability, but not to perfectionist level, not knocking yourself out. And you know what? The day you stop working on that one project, you're gonna be even more capable than you were the day you started. So if we were to just constantly redo everything, we would never stop. So I just wanted to impart this to you. Now, going back to the first few examples I gave you of social media, of strangers, I usually just delete and move on with my day. But I do follow a really beautiful, wonderful influencer named Jeffrey Marsh. They are non-binary and they do a lot of education around loving yourself and accepting yourself inside this community. And they don't delete the negative comments, they highlight them and then they make a video about them. And sometimes it is a very straightforward call to action, like please stop raising jerks. There's other times where, you know, they talk about them like, oh, love yourself and it's okay, like you don't need to feel like this and you don't need to take this out on people. They deal with it however they're feeling that day. Usually though, it's never really a negative thing. I mean, don't raise jerks, I feel like is a pretty strong positive statement, not a negative one. They are embracing of the negative comment, so it's not something you even need to be afraid of. Actually, Miranda Sings, the character from Colleen Ballinger, really made their whole career off of negative comments and had a show on Netflix for 2 seasons called Haters Back Off and has a song about reading negative comments. I think the bottom line in this little chat we're having here is you don't need to let this stop you from you doing you. Do you. Express yourself, be yourself, create for yourself, and share that with the world, but make sure you are doing it to your own liking, to your own standards, and then present it with confidence. Don't try to please everyone. Don't change to fit everyone's preferences. The only preferences that should matter to you are you. And that will draw your people to you. I get very, very, very few negative comments. And when I do, I take pause if there's anything I can glean from that. And if there isn't, I just delete. So I hope this was helpful for you. Let me know how you feel about this. If there's anything else I missed, let me know. And I hope to see you fully expressed and not worrying about this. All right, lots of love. Bye for now.